Cecil began at the museum in 2021, working to expand public and scholarly understanding of faith, spirituality, and religion in World War I. She curates exhibitions, interprets and organizes the collection, publishes in scholarly and lay media, and develops presentations, just like this one. Cecil holds a master's in Indigenous Studies and Museum Studies from the University of Kansas. You can shout out to the Jayhawks in the chat if you'd like to, but if you would right now, please join me in welcoming curator Trish Cecil.
Thank you so much, Laura, and thank you, everyone. Good evening. I'm Patricia Cecil, Specialist Curator for Faith, Religion, and World War I at the National World War I Museum and Memorial. And I'm so glad that you could join me for a special look at Fighting with Faith, a World War I POW camp of propaganda, which is the newest online exhibition at the National World War I Museum and Memorial. The National World War I Museum and Memorial is hosting all public programs online this week. As Laura mentioned, we have the good fortune of hosting the NFL on our grounds this Thursday through Saturday for the 2023 NFL Draft. So I would like to virtually welcome you all into my home and into the online exhibition which I served as lead curator on tonight. Thanks for being here, and I hope you enjoy this behind-the-scenes experience of Fighting with Faith, a World War I POW camp of propaganda. So, Fighting with Faith can be viewed as both a companion exhibit and as a standalone online exhibit. For those of you in the Kansas City area, you may know that we have a temporary physical exhibit in Wiley Gallery right now called Captured. It closes April 30th. So if you're in the area and haven't seen it, this weekend is your last weekend to be able to see that exhibition in Wiley Gallery. Captured examines the experiences of World War I POWs. And this exhibit, Fighting with Faith, was conceived of as a space to provide a deeper dive into a very specific prisoner of war camp for those who visit Captured. It was also intended as an exhibit that could be viewed alone and have a longer life online than the physical exhibition. To meet these needs, Fighting with Faith is an examination of one very specific place in the war and its larger resonance. In 1915, Germany built a mosque in a prisoner of war camp. The camp population was made up of soldiers of diverse militaries, nationalities, ethnicities, and languages. The soldiers all had one thing in common, their Islamic faith. And tonight we will be actually visiting the online exhibition. That is what you can see on my screen right now. I'll be kind of guiding you through a tour of the exhibit, pointing out some interesting images and walking you through the narrative of the exhibition. This won't be a comprehensive look at the exhibit, so I welcome you to come back after the program is over in the next few days or weeks and really do an in-depth exploration of the online exhibition. So the origins of the first mosque on German soil, built in the Wunsdorf-Zossen prisoner of war camp outside Berlin, it was nicknamed Halbmondlager or Half Moon Camp, lie in Germany and the Ottoman Empire at the start of the Great War. 2 months after war broke out in the summer of 1914, Germany and the Ottoman Empire formed a military alliance to meet shared goals of national protection, territorial expansion, and military strength. Not everyone was on board with this Ottoman-German alliance. Many within the Ottoman Empire did not want to go to war with or join with Germany. To influence popular opinion about the war, German and Ottoman leadership planned on using faith to gain support for their cause. And right here is a quote from a private in the Ottoman army that illustrates one of these sort of personal sentiments that was found within the Ottoman Empire about this potential alliance with Germany. Quote, "I cannot imagine myself fighting in the desert front. And why should I go? To fight for my country? I'm Ottoman by name only, for my country is the whole of humanity. Even if I am told that by going to fight, we will conquer Egypt, I will refuse to go." So Germany and the Ottoman Empire had both challenges to win over the hearts and minds of people within their own countries for this alliance, and also people outside of their countries to support this alliance. One of the ways they sought to do that was through the Islamic faith. Islam increasingly gained global recognition during the latter half of the 19th century. This idea started popping up in a lot of literature within and with outside the Muslim world of pan-Islam, the idea that all Muslims across the globe could be united under one central figure leader in the caliph. As the 20th century progressed, new communication tools put groups in contact with one another quickly, and global Muslim populations could communicate freely over thousands of miles. Muslims could now identify as one community with leadership under the caliph. And the caliph was widely recognized as both the Sultan of the Ottoman Empire and as the worldwide leader of the community of Islam, the Ummah. The caliph traced his leadership role from Abu Bakr, the father-in-law of the Prophet Muhammad. You can see this quote down here: "The caliph is the shadow of God on earth, the exitant of his decrees. All Muslims should obey him, being thankful if he does right, patient if he does wrong." And during World War I, Mehmed V was Sultan of the Ottoman Empire and caliph. People within the Ottoman Empire and also those outside of the Ottoman Empire, so Muslims in Egypt and British-controlled India, understood him to be the spiritual leader of his people. But by the time it becomes a little bit more complicated during World War I, because the Mehmed V surrendered all of his leadership authority as Sultan to the Young Turk movement that took over government leadership in the Ottoman Empire. And then Mehmed V served in the position of Sultan and Caliph largely as a figurehead. But he still had this religious authority as Caliph, recognized by many Muslims across the globe. So around this time in the years leading up to World War I, Muslim groups had started talking to each other, and empirical powers like Great Britain and France started to become very concerned with the potential that different Muslim groups across the world could start communicating with each other and identify as one group. And this idea really took off and became known as pan-Islam. So this infographic over here, this very early infographic, this is actually from 1907, 1908, shows a breakdown in population of sort of the Muslim world. So at the time of the war's outbreak, Great Britain controlled Egypt, India, and other South Asian lands. So this was these were the largest Muslim populations in the world, and they were controlled by Great Britain. France, with colonies in North Africa, was not far behind. Russia, too, had large Muslim populations in the Caucasus Mountain region. And Great Britain, France, and Russia all used colonial subjects in the war effort, and many subjects lived under oppressive conditions supporting the larger empires. So many men who were living in countries like in North Africa or in India were often coerced or forced to join colonial armies and to go serve on the Western Front or to serve in labor roles, so building roads, digging ditches, things like that. If mobilized, a Muslim uprising could pose a threat to the imperial powers of Europe. These were large groups of people being mobilized to work for war, and if they were disrupted, it could prove very, it could have radical consequences for those European imperial powers. One of Germany and the Ottoman Empire's joint goals was to weaken the rival empires and allied countries, Great Britain, Russia, and France. Together, Ottoman and German propaganda groups developed Islamic propaganda to support the German-Ottoman alliance. The propaganda used the Islamic concept of jihad to motivate support for the Central Powers and attempted to spur revolt in enemy territories to keep military forces in the colonies. So not only did Germany and the Ottoman Empire wish to turn soldiers that were already serving for these colonies into soldiers for the Central Powers, they also wanted to foment revolution back in the colonial territories to basically incite riots and revolution and destabilize these regions. So if you destabilize India because there's a Muslim revolt, then Great Britain has to deal with that problem in India and has less resources to focus on the battlefields on the Western Front. The same with France and also with Russia on the Eastern Front. So this was a very attractive idea to both Germany and the Ottoman Empire, because not only could they potentially affect soldiers within these countries, but they could also affect groups in the colonies. So one of the main arms of this propaganda that Germany and the Ottoman Empire sought to instill was propaganda in a prisoner of war camp, which is what brings us to Halbmondlager, or the Half Moon Camp in Germany. As I just mentioned, the German Information Office of the East, which was the sort of propaganda unit that created this very specific Islamic propaganda, recognized that Great Britain, France, and Russia would use colonial subjects in the war effort. As many of these subjects were Muslim, they developed a prisoner of war camp for these soldiers, and the camp would be a direct arm of jihad propaganda. So here we have some photographs of prisoners in the prisoner of war camp. So Germany built the Halbmondlager to be their flagship facility. And by all accounts, prisoners received more amenities and better treatment at Halbmondlager than at any other German prisoner of war camp. There was more space between buildings. There were many more buildings. The ratio of buildings to prisoners was much higher at Halbmondlager. There was more food. There were more cigarettes and sort of luxury rations. There was also more leisure time for the prisoners. Prisoners also received educational training and lectures. So the science of agriculture and also other skilled trades, those were educational lectures that prisoners received. It was sort of this idea that German leadership had that if they were trained or given skills, it would make them trust the German government more. You know, they were teaching them how to harvest crops out of the land scientifically. They were teaching them a skill that they could use after the war. So it was kind of more buying sort of more of this goodwill. They also featured religious dietary accommodations. There were religious lectures, and a large component of the Halbmondlager camp was the freedom of religious expression and worship for the prisoners. The converse of this sort of good treatment, if you will, is that prisoners were also subjected to ever-present German and Ottoman propaganda. So the prisoners were constantly being given and consuming this propaganda that was created specifically for them by Germany. So here's an example of some. These are newspapers. The German Intelligence Office for the East created foreign language newspapers for the prisoners of war. The papers aimed to portray Germany and the Ottoman Empire in a positive light. They often featured articles reporting on successes of the German military. They also frequently reported on cruelties of enemy empires. So Great Britain, France, and Russia, kind of their cruelties and injustices towards Muslims. They also featured outside speakers to come and lecture for the prisoners. And the another arm of the propaganda was official visits. So Turkish officials often visited the Half Moon Camp. These visits were intended to boost prisoner morale, and they often focused on fostering this sort of idea of a pan-Islamic solidarity. These visits were also a great source of propaganda material for Germany and the Ottoman Empire for outside media. So for German media and Turkish media, they could use these photographs of these visiting dignitaries, seeing and talking with the prisoners of war, visiting the prisoner of war camp, and sort of spreading this goodwill. And as I mentioned there too, the outside media, they widely and Halbmondlager was their flagship facility. So they frequently invited journalists into the camp, distributed photographs of prisoners, you know, in leisure activities or having, you know, seemingly having all this fun at the camp. And this was a tool so they could sort of look, show the world and say, look at how well, you know, we're treating these prisoners of war, Germany and the Ottoman Empire. You know, we care, we're good friends to Muslims all over the world. And thus you should support our support the Central Powers and support us winning the war. As I stated, religious expression and freedom of worship was a key component of activities at the Half Moon Camp. And so a central fixture of this was the mosque that was built at Halbmondlager. And the mosque was actually the first functioning mosque built on German soil. And the mosque itself at Halbmondlager was an arm of this jihadist holy war propaganda. From the beginning of the Half Moon Camp, there were plans to build a mosque. German leadership viewed promotion of religious practice as a cornerstone of their propaganda. The Ottoman Empire also strongly advocated for Muslim prisoners of war to have a place to worship. Rumors spread inside the camp and in sort of German agencies outside of the camp that the mosque was a gift of the Kaiser, that it was built at the insistence of and paid for by Kaiser Wilhelm II. There was this big narrative in Germany and beyond that the Kaiser was this great friend to Muslim people and that he considered himself a caretaker of the Muslim people and the protector of the Muslim world. So this idea that this mosque was a gift of the Kaiser to these Muslim prisoners of war really supported this ideal German story that he was their protector, he was their benefactor, and would do all he could to ensure the survival of Muslim people during and beyond World War I. However, in reality, it was the German military administration that funded the mosque construction, and we have evidence in letters that it was actually prisoners of war themselves that constructed the mosque. So there are no official records of it in any sort of German papers. We have architectural records and like right here, we have elevation plans and architectural plans for the mosque itself, but very little official documentation on actual construction. And there are letters that exist from prisoners of war at Halbmondlager to their family members, especially frequently Russian Muslim prisoners of war writing home saying, you know, we're building this mosque or we built this mosque and we didn't get paid for it. But the legend that the Kaiser himself financed this mosque and gave it to the prisoners of war as a gift really lived on inside and outside of Germany. And it was sort of this prevalent cultural myth into even the 1990s. So the mosque itself at Halbmondlager was a collage of Islamic architecture from around the world. So if we look at this map, this kind of shows some of the origins of a few of the groups of POWs at Halbmondlager, and we really see a concentration in India and in Northern Africa. And we see that reflected in the really unique architecture of the mosque at the Half Moon Camp. The mosque itself was this collage, as I said, of Islamic architecture from around the world. And the regional styles were meant to appeal to prisoners' memories of their home countries and spaces that they would have seen or perhaps worshipped in at home. The largest influence on the mosque was the Dome of the Rock in Jerusalem. The central dome here on the mosque, kind of the largest component and the largest interior room inside the mosque, is very, very heavily influenced by the Dome of the Rock. The Dome of the Rock is the oldest surviving major monument of Islam and is considered by Muslims to be the most sacred place on earth next to the Kaaba in Mecca. The mosque at the Half Moon Camp drew its largest influence from this Islamic site because of its religious importance. The mosque's designers wanted to use the visibility and importance of the Dome of the Rock to gain influence for Germany and the Ottoman Empire in the minds of prisoners. Every day when prisoners went to worship at the mosque, they would have been confronted with the physical reality of the ornate structure and the active German-Ottoman myth-making which surrounded its construction and use. So here we can see the Dome of the Rock in Jerusalem in this photograph, and you can see the central dome feature here. Looks very, very much like the one we see in the Half Moon Camp. Other architectural styles at the Half Moon Camp Mosque is Mughal Indo-Islamic. So the extended S-shape arch that you can see right here is frequently used in Mughal architecture. That arch is repeated on the Half Moon Camp Mosque. And prisoners of war from South Asia would have recognized this design feature. It was very common in the Indo-Islamic architecture in India. This sort of central screen in front of the front entrance of the mosque, the triple arched entrance facade with a sebkha design is Andalusian. And the best known examples of Andalusian architecture are the Alhambra of Granada, and also other monuments in Seville. The sebkha design is also a prominent feature of architecture in Morocco. So this very distinctive West Islamic architecture would have been very familiar to North African prisoners of war. The striped banding on the side of the mosque is Mamluk architecture. The alternating horizontal bands in red and gray are often featured in Mamluk architecture, especially two mosques in Cairo. This would have been another sort of appeal or nod to the North African prisoners of war that would have lived or been being held at the Half Moon Camp. This minaret up here itself is very distinctive. It is an Ottoman minaret. They're also known as sort of pencil-shaped minarets. They have a square base, a slender cylindrical shaft, and a pointed top. This architectural reference itself would have been a nod to the Ottoman Empire and sort of their overarching presence within the Half Moon Camp, as sort of the other actor in the partnership between Germany and the Ottoman Empire. So the global Islamic architecture of the mosque was a direct attempt to cue prisoners' religious values and cultural memories to inspire allegiance to the German-Ottoman cause. So this was a very physical way that Germany and the Ottoman Empire expressed their propaganda for those prisoners of war. And it would have been, you know, a very prominent and an obvious site within the camp. So a very common question with this topic or with the Half Moon Camp, this elaborate campaign of propaganda that was waged by Germany and the Ottoman Empire is, was it successful? Germany dedicated a large amount of planning and significant resources to propaganda for Muslim prisoners of war. So was it successful? Did it work? And the campaign by most measures was a failure. Some POWs did join the alliance. About 800 prisoners from the Half Moon Camp registered for the Ottoman army and actually traveled to Turkey. But most Muslim POWs from the Half Moon Camp, about 84%, did not join the Ottoman alliance. And a global Muslim revolution to overthrow English, French, and Russian empires never materialized during World War I. So why was that? Well, a large factor was prisoner attitudes. Most prisoners who were being held at the Half Moon Camp did not buy into the German Ottoman propaganda that was being sold to them. They didn't adhere to this concept of jihad or holy war that leadership was sort of constantly presenting them with. The prisoners' own personal understandings of Islam and teachings about jihad and their own ties to communities and their countries of origin, even their colonial identities were stronger than the propaganda, were stronger than the experiences of this camp. I love this this print in the exhibit because it illustrates this idea so well. It depicts these German soldiers speaking to a French colonial soldier from Africa. And the soldier's words translated from French read, "I don't care about a sultan. I don't know him. I'm French, sir." So it really illustrates this concept that there was no real pan-Islam. The individual experiences and ideas and beliefs held by the soldiers themselves were more powerful than the propaganda that Germany and the Ottoman Empire was presenting. Family and economic issues were also motivators. Many prisoners who were being held at the Half Moon Camp feared punishments for family in their home countries or a loss of their military pensions if they were to switch sides and fight for the enemy. There were also major health concerns at Halbmondlager that played a role in the attitudes and behaviors of prisoners. By 1917, many of the prisoners from Africa and India had fallen quite ill at the camp. And as a result, German leadership transferred them to Romania, where German leadership thought the climate would be more suitable for their health. Excuse me. So the camp sort of starts to deteriorate within 2 to 3 years. Another large factor was stories from former prisoners who joined the Ottoman German cause. They were very unhappy with the new military, with the Ottoman army. The Ottomans used volunteers from Halbmondlager at the Iraqi front, and most of the former prisoners felt badly treated by their Ottoman officers. They frequently complained of mistreatment, of abuse, and of a lack of food. And they communicated this. Those who could write and were literate wrote to those back at the camp and told them, don't join the Ottoman army. It is not what they're telling you it is. It's absolutely terrible. And many of those recruits or volunteers ended up deserting the Ottoman army. Another reason that the Half Moon Camp and the propaganda that they were sort of selling to these prisoners failed because of leadership issues between Germany and the Ottoman Empire. From the beginning, German and Ottoman leadership argued over who held authority over the prisoners in the camp, over the messages within the camp, over the religious leaders that were allowed in the camp, dignitaries. Basically, if you could argue over it, they would. The German military complicated this further when they wrested control of the camp from the German intelligence office for the East. So if you recall, that's sort of the office that was in charge of all of this propaganda. So the German military ended up taking control of the camp. And then these internal and external rivalries really just plagued the campaign. So there were also consequences outside of the camp, outside of the prisoners themselves and leadership that was directly involved in the running of the camp. The camp and the propaganda itself failed, but there were notable effects from the camp and the ideas itself that it spread. Propaganda impacted other empires' relationships with Muslim populations, especially the French and the British. So the French were sort of victims of a constant bombardment of German propaganda saying that they treated their Muslim subjects terribly, that they were abusive, that they were these terrible colonial masters, and that Muslims should overthrow them as soon as possible. So the French tried to counter these claims with their own French brand of propaganda, specifically for their own French colonial soldiers and the colonial subjects still living in North Africa. This campaign included a lot of really sort of proud posters and flyers celebrating the colonial French soldier. And it also involved building a mosque in France for colonial soldiers, which was a direct reply to the mosque at the Half Moon Camp. This, a lot of these efforts, though, were extremely hollow for the French. There was no real change to colonial policy and a lot of negative French attitudes towards colonial Muslim subjects did not change. So a lot of what the French put forth, sort of challenges to this German propaganda or feelings of colonial soldiers, it was just sort of all for show for them. They kind of just put out a lot of posters and build a mosque, but didn't really let anyone use it. So it was kind of a very hollow effort. Great Britain reacted with force, on the other hand. They had much to lose if Muslim colonial subjects decided to revolt. And this included the potential to lose significant global power and influence. There's this idea that India was the crown jewel in Britain's imperial crown, and you couldn't lose India, so it must be protected at all costs. So the idea of a Muslim revolt was a very threatening idea to Great Britain. So the British diverted troops and materials away from the main battlefields on the Western Front and sent troops to the Ottoman Front and beyond into the Middle East. Great Britain's engagement deepened in the Middle East because of this for the entire 4 years of the war. And this really drove a lot of resources away from the Western Front, and some historians argued prolonged the length of the Great War on the Western Front because Great Britain became so invested on the Ottoman Front and in the Middle East. And eventually, Great Britain's response resulted in the fracturing of the Middle East via the Sykes-Picot Agreement. These decisions influenced the control of Islam and the future leadership of the Middle East. So the British had their own sort of ideas behind these military campaigns. If you remember earlier, we talked about Mehmed V as the Sultan Caliph, the leader of the Ummah, the global Islam community. But what the British wanted to do was to just take him out of the equation. So kind of remove the leader and be able to control sort of global Islam themselves by installing a new leader. So the British's strategy was to replace the Ottoman Sultan Caliph and install the Sharif of Mecca as the highest ranking Muslim authority. This would, in theory, give Great Britain control over the leader of the Ummah. It would also give them power over the destiny of the Middle East once the Ottoman Empire fell. In the course of this plan, leadership of Great Britain made many promises of self-rule and independence to leaders in the Arabian Peninsula, most all of which were broken after the end of the war. So Great Britain really tried to invest in controlling Islam, controlling this potential for revolt. And that ultimately really fractured and remapped the Middle East and laid the foundation for unrest and conflict in the Middle East that we felt through the 20th century and still into the 21st century. So the mosque at the Half Moon Camp was a physical manifestation of German Ottoman propaganda. The propaganda campaign attempted to use the religion of Islam to foster a global geopolitical revolution to destabilize and weaken rival empires. Ultimately, it was an immediate failure in the perspective of the First World War, but the campaign itself bore cultural, political, and religious repercussions that reverberate to today. So there's, as I mentioned before, there's much more to this exhibit than what we covered tonight. So I hope you will take the opportunity to revisit the online exhibit, Fighting with Faith, in the very near future. The online exhibition will be on our website in perpetuity. So you can visit the National World War I Museum and Memorial online. If you click on exhibits, you'll get a list of our current physical exhibits and also a list of our online exhibits, and Fighting with Faith will be there. So I welcome you to access the online exhibit at another time, kind of engage in the material on a deeper level. But I hope that this was enjoyable and informative this evening. Thank you so much for joining me.
Patricia, thank you so much. And thank you all for asking questions in that Q&A for those who've been kind of sending them in. We look forward to asking some follow-up questions here. And also feel free, this is the joy of an online program like this. Go ahead, you can multitask. Go straight to the website right now, www.theworldwar.org. Check it out. I know some of you were actually following along as Trish was talking. So that is absolutely delightful. I'm going to pick up some of the different questions that we have going on here. And first from Stephen Slaughter. If we, and this may be outside of the wheelhouse, I know when people ask me any question that hits on World War II, I generally decline. However, it's a great question, so we'll go ahead and ask it. Do you know if the Axis powers might have used this World War I attempt as a history lesson in their crafting of propaganda in Muslim regions in World War II? And I could speak a little bit more generally to German propaganda in some of Germany's learning and of propaganda. They did recognize that the United States and other areas, Britain in particular, really had some very strong propaganda machines. And there was studying of that craft that occurred in the 1920s and the 1930s that many scholars who focus on World War II will go back and reference and say that there was some, but I don't know about specifically with religion as that kind of framework. Trish?
Sure. So I do know that Germany would have looked back to the German Office of the East, and the man who ran it, Max von Oppenheim, actually played a significant role in propaganda in the Second World War. He was around for that second go around too. So he definitely took some of the things that he learned from the Half Moon Camp in the way he crafted propaganda and disseminated it. And he actually applied it more broadly. So not just for Muslim populations during World War II, but sort of the whole German propaganda arm during World War II. They took those lessons and he sort of applied them more broadly.
Both Kent Kirby and David Price ask, is the mosque that was at the Half Moon Camp still standing?
Oh, it is not still standing. It was demolished around 1925. So the mosque stood for a little while after the end of World War I. There were some Russian prisoners of war who could not return to Russia because of the revolution going on that sort of hung around in the area, used the mosque until they eventually went back to Russia in the mid-1920s. And there was also a group of Muslims living in Berlin. So Wunsdorf-Zosen, the location of the camp, is very close to Berlin. So there's a small group of Muslims who lived in Berlin, and they used the mosque up until about 1925 for their holy days. Around 1925, they raised enough money as a community and built their own mosque inside Berlin. So the mosque fell into disrepair. There were sort of these long bureaucratic back and forths between Germany and Turkey saying, who's going to pay for this? I'm not paying for it. You're going to pay for it. It's falling down. You know, it's on your soil. Take care of it. No, it was for, you know, your faith. You take care of it. So there's this sort of big bureaucratic back and forth. And then finally Germany just tore down the mosque and eventually repurposed the grounds themselves for government storage of tanks and other sort of large scale industrial machines.
There are a couple of questions, including this one from Walter Peters, about divisions in Islam between the Shia and the Sunni. Was the failure of this propaganda campaign at any point due to any sort of internal division, or was there any sort of recording of sectarian conflicts between Sunni and Shia prisoners at the Half Moon Camp?
Oh, I think one of the failures itself was Germany didn't heed or understand fully the internal divisions and differences within Islam. They sort of had this blanket idea of what Islam is, and they didn't understand the deeply rooted divisions within the religion itself, and also just ethnically and tribally, how different groups, especially at that time, understood Islam. So I think that is a reflection of the broader failure of Germany to really understand the groups of people they were trying to influence.
It's a great segue to Raina Mallory's question. Notes that you mentioned the negative French attitude towards Islam. Were there reactions of the average German to this Half Moon Camp being built in Germany? And could you mention again the city, the location of the Half Moon Camp?
Sure. So the location is Wunsdorf-Zosen. It's a hyphen, so Wunsdorf with a W. And then hyphen Zosen with a Z and a double S. It's a small community just outside Berlin. Could you repeat the first half of that question
before the location? Was there the average German? Are you aware of what their reaction was to this camp being built, to a mosque being built in Germany?
Sure. So the average German, this is a great question. And we have a fair amount of evidence because people wrote about this experience because it was so novel. A lot of German families would host in the area, would host the Muslim prisoners of war in their homes. There was almost this cultural exchange program that went on between the prisoners and German people. It was this larger idea of that Germany was trying to get across of, look at how great we're doing. Look at our culture, our civilization. Our people are so welcoming. You'll want to side with us and be on our side. So a main component of that was sort of this cultural outreach, you know, host a prisoner in your home, or they would take prisoners out on tours of countrysides and fields or German industry to show them, you know, just sort of kind of how great and powerful Germany was. And so the average sort of people living in and around Berlin were, for lack of a better term, sort of fascinated by the prisoners of war in the camp. There's a quote, and I'm paraphrasing, that I came across where someone wrote that traveling to the Halbmondlager, the Half Moon Camp, was just as good as a trip around the world, because there were all these different people, all these different ethnicities, these cultures in this one camp. So a lot of the local people sort of looked at it with a fascination. Like, you can see all these different groups of people. There was a very big movement also in Germany at the time of, you know, scientific discipline and inquiry. So you can learn about all these cultures. It's this amazing, enriching experience for the people around the town in Germany to come and experience culture. They really didn't treat the prisoners with any sort of xenophobia or disdain. It really was this sort of pushed idea that for the German people, these are our guests and we're hosting them, and we have to kind of put our best face forward because we're trying to help, trying to get them to join our side. So if anything, it was both this gracious hospitality because we're hosting you, but also this intense, almost stereotypical sort of fascination of the other, you know, a travel around the world in your backyard sort of experience.
How are these experiences of prisoners recorded and preserved so that we've got this fabulous online exhibition today?
Absolutely. So I mentioned sort of this German movement in the social sciences and sort of scientific inquiry. Germany actually sent in linguists and anthropologists into the Halbmondlager to record the music, the stories, the poems, just the language of these prisoners of war. And they categorized it and documented it with painstaking detail. So for every recording, there's a form filled out that says who recorded, who's the artist, how old they are, any sort of biographical data, the language which they spoke. So it's very this sort of, on one hand, very scary, ethnographic, sort of scientific inquiry in a prisoner of war camp that at the time and is borne out in the next kind of decades, we can see kind of the nefarious side to it. But then we also have 100 years later, people like myself, who then have this incredible record of the prisoners who were there at the camp, and not only an incredible record, but to be able to hear their voices or hear their music. It's pretty fantastic.
Do we know if any of the 800 prisoners who defected to the Ottoman army were punished for treason?
You know, that I don't know. That's a really great question. The records are so spotty once prisoners join the Ottoman army, because so many just disappeared. They would just defect and never be heard from again. And it was a lot easier to disappear back then than it is now. So we don't have, I know we do not have evidence that any prisoner did not get their pension from a colonial power, if that makes sense. So if you did not defect to the Central Powers, and let's say you were an Algerian soldier, so you were a French colonial and you went back home, you received your pension. There are some who did, I should say, defect and wrote later to Germany and said that, you know, they risked a lot of things and it certainly didn't turn out the way that they thought it was and that it would. And they were pretty mad at Germany about it and said, basically, you know, now I'm stuck in this foreign land, Turkey. And I really just want to go back to, you know, India or North Africa, but now I'm stuck here. And what are you going to do now that the war is over and we lost? Basically, we have one, I came across one set of letters of a gentleman who stayed in Turkey 14 years after World War I and continually wrote to the German government saying, I switched sides, I fought for you guys, and now I'm here. Get me back home.
With such good treatment being kind of poured out and a priority in the Half Moon Camp, did the captivity of any of these prisoners and their experiences there, once they were released back to their colonial powers, is there any record that they sought better treatment from that colonial power because of their better treatment at Halbmondlager.
So I'm not sure if it may have anything to do with the Half Moon Camp, that specific experience, but I do know a lot of colonial soldiers when they went back, whether they became prisoners of war or not, really had this sense of, I fought and died for this country. Now I should be respected as a full citizen of this country with all the rights afforded to any other citizen. So there were quite a few labor movements, workers' rights movements, social reform movements that took place in colonial countries. So it wasn't this huge, giant sort of, you know, Muslim overthrow revolt that Germany and the Ottoman Empire hoped for, but it definitely was this experience of the returning veteran saying, I sacrificed something, you know, for my country, for this country. I am owed the full rights in respect of a citizen of this country.
Are you aware of who might oversee the museum that is at the former camp today?
No, I do not. There is a museum. There's a small museum on the site. And I do know that they were conducting archaeological digs as recent as 5 years ago, especially around the site where the mosque was located. So there's a small museum. You can visit sort of the archaeological sites, and they walk you through the history of the Halbmondlager, and then also what has happened in the intervening years.
Our final question. We've had some really good ones. I'm hoping to make sure that I just have been catching these. Did with the experiences, as you mentioned earlier in one of your in one of your conversations, where these prisoners were experiencing the German countryside and German civilians, did that do anything to dispel Germany's stereotypes of colonial soldiers or of Muslims?
I think so. And also, you know, Germany at the time, I think we sort of have this idea of Germany in World War One as kind of like the proto-Nazis or just kind of before Nazis. And actually, so at this time, coming into World War One, Germany itself was a fairly sort of socially liberal state. So there was a lot of religious tolerance in Germany. And by far, of all the Western European powers, it was the most religiously tolerant of any of the belligerent nations in World War One. So I think I'm not really sure of sort of the in your face sort of discrimination that any Muslim prisoners of war would have felt in sort of towns or around people. I feel like more it would have been like they were viewed as sort of an eccentricity or an oddity. But I think by and large, Germany was sort of projecting itself to the world and took a lot of internal pride that they were a very tolerant peoples and a very forward-thinking peoples, especially for the time.
One last question, because you and I have spoken about it and it has arisen again. You mentioned that there was a big emphasis on Britain and India. And I know in some of our behind the scenes conversations as you were building this, you would laugh that people might have misunderstood what religion people in India might have been actually been practicing. So this is a bit of a two-part question. Were Germans more aware of kind of the differences of Hinduism and Islam of those coming in from those spaces? And are you aware for any South Asians, were there any conflicts with caste?
Okay, so So Germany was definitely aware of the religious variations within India. The German government had scholars working for them that were experts in the area, both within religion and in anthropology. So they sort of had their top minds of the universities sort of looking at this. So Germany itself, when they think about India, they were very aware that there are Hindus and there are Muslims. There were divisions within religion in India sort of shaking out themselves at this time, which I don't really think a lot of people were aware of in the world. Anyways, but Germany was very aware of the difference between Hindus and Muslims. And that's really why this group at Halbmondlager was majority Muslim and caste wasn't an issue, because there weren't any Hindus. There were very few. There were some Gurkha prisoners, which are not Muslim, that were there, but they didn't receive the intense propaganda that wasn't Germany didn't view Hinduism as having the same opportunity to sort of be used as a tool of propaganda as Islam. And really a lot of soldiers in the Indian army that were coming over were actually Muslim themselves. So there was already a disproportionate amount of Muslims within the Indian army for other reasons, which I'm not going to go into. But so really they weren't, the Germans weren't very concerned with Hindus, to be more concise.
So friends, if you haven't gone already, go to www.theworldwar.org. Check out Fighting with Faith, a World War I POW camp of propaganda. And as Trish mentioned, Captured is going to close this weekend. You can see a cartoon that does in fact kind of mistake some of the differences of religion that is on display in that exhibition, but you can just catch it this weekend. If you're in and around the Kansas City area, that means you should be getting that One Pass app for the NFL draft. We would again welcome all of you to join us on site as we partner with the NFL this week. And if you are anywhere around the world, we would encourage you to again join us on Friday, May 12th, as we partner with the American Battle Monuments Commission to recognize their 100th anniversary. And we look at a documentary that looks at American military service and the meaning and mission of the American Battle Monuments Commission. And also, if you want to find out more about prisoners of war and the prisoner of war experience, we encourage you to join us next week as we speak with Dr. Heather Jones, who was a historical advisor for Captured. She is going to be our final program for that exhibition, and we couldn't be more delighted to talk with her about those global experiences, of which this deep conversation with our specialist curator, Patricia Cecil, has been fascinating and hopefully has just piqued your interest. So find us back at our website, find us at more programs. And again, thank you for being here, for learning live. Thank you for watching online later on. And thank you, especially for all of you who are members.